Okay.
Okay, folks, I'd like to welcome you to our second lunchtime lecture. Thank you all very much for coming. Great to see such a cool turnout. And our speaker today is Dr Michael Finneran, who surprisingly enough is going to talk to us about Irish drama. He seems to know something about that subject. I don't know if that's true or not.
You can be the judge.
He says he does anyway, so we listen to him and we'll see what happens. Sounds like a fascinating talk because Mike, of course, is both an academic in the field of drama, a practitioner, he's involved in directing, producing, so you get the full performance of the whole thing from him. So it's one I'm looking forward to, so no pressure, Mike. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Eugene. I'm being Eugene as being too kind in many respects, not the least of which he's actually acting as director today. So I've been told that I have to deliver within camera shot. Is that fair to say? It's a little intimidating to be introduced as someone who knows what they're doing. I deny all responsibility and knowledge of that. But I suppose I do want to spend a little time today with you and thank you for your presence. Thank you for being here. Thinking about Irish theatre and thinking about the place, I suppose, of Irish theatre. It's something that's of huge importance to me, both professionally and personally. It's something that's of major significance in my life, but also something that continues to perplex and confuse me, I suppose, in some respects. And when I was writing the intro for this particular talk, I thought of the Italian playwright, ironically, Luigi Pirandello, who wrote a famous play called Six Characters in Search of an Author. Because very often my quest to try and find some meaning with regard to Irish theatre involves multiple personalities, as Eugene has alluded to, being a practitioner on occasion, but being an academic and being someone who's involved now in cultural policy and governance. So I occupy many of those multiple personalities at times. But also, not so much in search of an author, but in search of a metaphor, trying to find some way of helping myself make sense of what Irish theatre might be. And that's the reason for the title of this talk, The Limestone Effect, because I suppose I've come to the conclusion that limestone is probably a suitable metaphor in many respects for Irish theatre. Let me explain why. When one thinks of limestone, one thinks of the burn. Vast expanses of sheetrock exposed to the wild Atlantic wind and rain. Permanent, monumental, a symbol of national identity, an identifier of a place, of home to rare and exotic wildflowers. Inhospitable, as you can tell in the picture, yet, ironically, a very, very welcoming place for visitors and strangers alike. When I think of limestone again, I tend to think of growing up on a West of Ireland farm. I'm in danger of slipping into a particular trope of Irish studies here, but I do think of growing up on a West of Ireland farm, where the thin layer of earth barely covered the rock, and where we used to engage in a pursuit called picking stones. And that was, you know, trying to reclaim land and gathering the various pieces of rock in order to make the field useful for animals or for crops. Any kind of excavation would involve gathering large quantities of these or trying to penetrate the surface rock in order to erect a building, a fence, or merely encouraging the grass to grow. More laterally, when I think of limestone, I think of my kettle. I'm a great fan of tea. But I think of the fact that I have to replace the kettle every so often, because in Limerick, we have what's known as hard water, as it's colloquially known. We tend to have an awful lot of limestone in the water. So our kettles, I'm sure many of you who live around here will have suffered the same fate, our kettles tend to burn out at a regular rate. So limestone has been actually a feature of my life, an incredibly important and ever-present feature, albeit not a particularly visible one or not a particularly prominent one, and one that I haven't actually given much thought to other than for the reasons of this case. This is the case for many, many Irish people. Because when you look at the statistics, this is a map from the Geological Survey of Ireland that maps the limestone distribution around Ireland, you will see that some 50% of the landmass of the Republic, 40% of the island as a whole, is limestone-based. Now, I'm not claiming for a second that this is in any way ubiquitous to Ireland. Limestone is, you know, there are many, many buildings all around the world that are limestone-built and made, and many, many landscapes that are limestone-based as well. But I suppose in Ireland it remains an important stone geographically, economically, in terms of construction, but also symbolically. Limestone is well represented in terms of the arts. W.H. Auden has a poem entitled In Praise of Limestone. I'll quote a little from that later on. And I suppose it's also safe to assume that Kavanagh was probably talking of limestone when he penned the famous Stony Grey Soil, which clogged the feet of his childhood and burgled his bank of youth. But I like the unseen nature of much of our limestone bedrock, and I want to play with that a little today. I like the idea that beneath us, much of the time, lies a hidden stratum, supporting our every move, nurturing our food with our minerals, providing the materials for our growth, draining our waste, filtering our water sources, and occasionally providing aesthetic pleasure, as in the previous slide, when our flanks emerge into the glorious pavements that link us both to nature, but also to a past unseen and at times unremembered. For me, the limestone as a cultural motif, as well as a geographical entity, is actually quite a powerful one. It is a rock that is permeable, porous, subject to rapid erosion, particularly from acids, and yet feels permanent, immovable, and almost beyond the vagaries of time and human intrusion. In Ireland, it is pervasive, it is solid, it is useful, it is useless, it is malleable, it is native. And I think many of those qualities are also associated with Irish theatre. And I think many of the things that I want to talk about today in terms of Irish theatre can be linked directly to that cultural motif of limestone. So, as I suggested, if we're to remove the word limestone from all of that text and replace it with theatre, it still pertains. For many of us, theatre is, I would hope, but actually I'm going to throw some statistics at you in a few minutes that betray my own argument. But it's, you know, I think it's perceived at times as being fundamental and intrinsic to our silent contemplation and public discourse of what it means to be Irish. You know, any conversation, any discourse around Irishness tends to make allusion to the theatre. And I suppose I question that at times. As an Irish person, it strikes me that we pay very little attention to our theatre, except perhaps on well-dressed evenings at the theatre. And on those evenings, and I tend to be present at quite a number of them, I look around, and I would argue that not everyone is present at those evenings at the theatre, or even well represented. Our theatre is a theatre that seems to belong in specific quarters, belongs to specific people, and only occasionally, as with Burn, where the limestone breaks through the landscape, only occasionally does it present itself to others. So in this paper I want to try and act as a sculptor, continuing my rock-derived metaphor, and carve from the limestone what I feel to be a representative image of Ireland today. I want to try and provoke, I don't claim to have all the questions, but I want the image carved to make sense to you, to the viewer, to be aesthetically pleasing if my craft allows, and more importantly to function as all good art should do, to allow the viewers to see something in perhaps a slightly different light, to ask questions that are perhaps gently critical, but loving nonetheless. So my core question is not an insubstantial one. What is Irish theatre today? I like small questions. What is Irish theatre today? How do we see and understand the great subterranean mass that can be understood as representing Irish theatre? And, you know, in trying to deal with that, I'm just going to address three specific sub-questions. How do we represent Irish theatre? Why might we be misrepresenting it? And what are the implications of our representation for the Irish theatre? So let's deal with the first of those. And I thought that a picture of the very sumptuous Abbey Theatre might provide them. I was going to put up the Lime Tree, which is our own theatre here on campus, but I thought that the National Theatre might provide a useful backdrop for this. I think it's fair to say that, aesthetically at least, Irish theatre is represented in public life, in academic discourse, in curricula, and indeed in the canon of Irish theatre as a success story. There's a number of distinct reasons for this. In terms of visibility in Irish public life, it is, in many respects, without a peer. You're no one unless, you know, you're seen at an opening night at the Abbey, or at the Gate, or at the Dublin Theatre Festival, or, you know, on that rare occasion when our Dublin-bound colleagues tend to leave the great metropolis for a summer recess in the Galway Arts Festival. Forgive my cynicism. But, you know, that notion of the theatre still being emblematic of, you know, a presence in being someone and of having a presence within Irish public life is still very, very strong. Irish theatre is internationally acclaimed. There's no two ways about that. We have prominent tours, prominent international runs. Culture Ireland, you know, I was trying to explain this to an international audience recently. We have an organisation in Ireland called Culture Ireland, which only funds, you know, Irish cultural works that go abroad. It doesn't actually fund any kind of work that remains in Ireland. But Culture Ireland, and you can understand why, it's a marketing tool and so on and so forth, and it has been incredibly successful in its marketing. It has brought tours of everything from Riverdance right through to Pat Kinnevan's Silent around the world over the last number of years. People like Enda Walsh, Sarah Green, who won a Tony recently on Broadway, Chris O'Dowd, Martin McDonagh, who's Anglo-Irish, and who incidentally has decided quite spectacularly not to write for theatre anymore. You know, works like Once, which is the musical now in the West End and Broadway, Ballyturk, which has just finished a run, in the National and the UK. I'll return to Ballyturk in a little while, but seemingly it's heading for Broadway as well. There is no doubt about it that Irish theatre is an incredibly marketable commodity. So it's visible, it's marketable, it's widely acclaimed. A lot of that is attributable, I would argue, to its incredibly powerful canon. And we've been really, really good, the Irish theatre community, whomsoever they might be, in appropriating and in, I suppose, protecting a canon of dramatic literature that stretches from the Anglo-Irish greats all the way through, you know, so Boucicault and Farquhar, people like that, who actually rarely, if ever, set foot on the island, through the very, very famous Gaelic revival. We've also regathered the expatriates who left because we weren't particularly hospitable towards them. I'm thinking of Beckett and Joyce and people like that, but who we now like to conveniently claim as our own. And then you've got a whole raft of the new giants of Irish modernism, the Conor MacPhersons, the MacDonaghs, and so on and so forth, right through to the proponents of a new contemporary scene, which is very exciting and internationally acclaimed as well. Look, you know, I could talk about the canon for a year and a day, and it's an incredibly kind of complex entity in itself, and there are too many factors to engage with here today. But you know, the one thing I would say is obviously there is an inherent quality to the work of our canon. There is a lyrical beauty, there is a quality of craftsmanship, there's a quality of prose that is undoubted. But I suppose we're also fortuitous in the sense that it is undoubtedly the case, I would argue, that our initially kind of romantic leanings in terms of some of that work, and thinking particularly of Boucicault and the Colleen Bawn and things like that, and then laterally the post-colonial identity effect has come into play. So that we're actually the inheritors of a tradition that's liked for a whole pile of reasons, and it's not altogether to do with the quality of the work. It's to do with our socio-cultural situation. It's to do with our socio-historical origins. But the simple reality is, if you look to the programme of any Western theatre company, if you look to any North American, any Australian, any European theatre company, you will find Irish work present. My origins obviously are very much in education. If you look to educational curricula, and I've been fortunate enough to travel to a number of places, you will find Irish plays being taught. So we have what is ostensibly a very visible theatre. We have an internationally acclaimed theatre. We have an incredibly strong canon. But for all of that, I would actually posit that at the heart of Irish theatre, there is a crisis. And I would use the term crisis in the Kuhnian sense. Thomas Kuhn talks of crisis in terms of pre-paradigmatic change, that the notion that something big is about to happen. Because at home, not many people go to places like this. Not many people come to our theatres. It's a minority pursuit. David Willetts, the English culture theorist, talked about theatre audiences as being 3M, middle-class, middle-aged minority. And I think that's probably a little redundant in many respects. But the most recently available figures, which are for 2013, indicate that 886,000 Irish adults attend the theatre annually, or did in that year, but with just over 500,000, 504,000, attending less than once a year. Now, given that the adult population in 2013 was reported as 3.6 million, this means that 382,000 people, which is 10.6% of the adult population, attend the theatre, any theatre, more than once a year. These figures are from the arts industry, and they don't differentiate between the type of performance. So, and based on my own experience, my own work, I would actually take that a little further, and I would say that it is safe to assume that a significant proportion of these attendees only attend amateur and community theatre. A more statistically detailed report identifies an even bigger chasm in terms of attendance in the arts, and it suggests that there appears to be a very strong impact of socioeconomic background, such that those in more disadvantaged circumstances are much less likely to attend arts events. Amongst other conclusions, the report identifies that education and attainment has the most consistent association with involvement across the range of arts activities, and that women are more involved in the arts than men. So for me, the theatre industry and the theatre phenomenon in Ireland is actually quite a divided house. It's one that claims public support, and yet has very little by means of hard data to actually verify that. It is one, and again, if you look to the discourse of the Irish professional theatre scene at the moment, it's one that's increasingly economically unviable. It is, and I would say this hand in heart, it is unsustainable for many as a career choice. And we've also had the phenomenon, in keeping with our recession over the last number of years, where the Arts Council have suffered massive cuts. And we've begun to hear questioning in public life around the fact, well, why on earth should we support the arts when we could be putting money into hospital beds? Why on earth, you know, should we give $500,000 to a theatre company to make a piece of work when that might, you know, employ two critical care nurses for a year in, you know, a high dependency situation? So that kind of disturbing rhetoric, that kind of divisive rhetoric, is indicative, I would argue, of the fact that there is a fundamental division there. It's also a theatre that is in artistic flux. You know, what we've seen clearly over the last number of years is a move from the stage to much more site-specific, devised, contemporary forms, which are fantastic and are exciting to see, but are actually arguably much less accessible than ever to their audiences. So the very question, you know, in addition to that, the very question of which we'd long assumed, that we are the inheritors and owners of a world-class tradition in theatre, was actually called into question last year. Many of you who are Irish-based will remember that in January, an Arts Council report into the Abbey Theatre was leaked. And it brought three world-class assessors in to watch a season of work in the Abbey Theatre, who found that the work was actually quite ordinary. So it questioned its artistic output. And yet, when you talk to the Abbey, and I'm doing a research project on their education programme at the moment, they would claim, with some justification, that their work has never been as diverse. It has never been as inclusive. There are more young people coming to the theatre, and it's much more. They show much more contemporary work, newly written work, as opposed to just the same old from the canon. Fintan O'Toole, who's the Irish theatre critic as well, Fintan, I think they say to you pretty much everything. He's for those of you who are visitors, if you listen to the radio long enough, you'll eventually hear him. He's that pervasive. But, you know, he started out as an Irish theatre critic, and he would say himself that he's had a lifelong and passionate affair with theatre. He's never been slow to express himself, and he did a beautiful television series last year called Power Plays, and he launched an absolutely excoriating attack on contemporary Irish theatre, accusing it of essentially having run out of ideas, of reinventing the canon and showing the canon as it was originally written and not as it should be contemporaneously understood, and more pertinently, of not dealing with the issues of post-Celtic Tiger Ireland. So, you know, it's impossible to deal with all of this in the abstract. So I'm just going to take you on a brief little trip through three recent theatre productions that I've had the good fortune to attend. And just, you know, I'm not claiming that these three are indicative of a trend in any way, shape or form, but I think it's useful to look at them in terms of what they actually represent. So the first, you recognise the image if you're fortunate to see it. The first is Ballyturk, which was at the Galway Arts Festival. I mentioned it earlier. It had an incredibly successful run in the National in London, and it's now heading for Broadway. That's Michael Murphy posing out front, and Killian Murphy, who is also very, very well known from film and TV, Batman, or some of the Batman movies behind him. So this was, you know, this has been critically acclaimed. But I suppose I would begin to question a little as to how respondent a piece it is, because in many respects it's Beckettian. It's set in a dungeon-like room, and the characters have no names. They interact with each other in a completely kind of random way. They're telling a story that they don't share with the rest of the audience. It is undoubtedly a beautiful piece of theatre. It is mind-bogglingly theatrical and dramatic. But for many, it was deeply inaccessible. And actually, many critics argued that as a script, as a piece of writing, it wasn't particularly good. But I suppose my experience of Ballyturk is going with my wife, going with my parents, my sister, who admired it aesthetically, but who came away thinking, what on earth was that? What had that got to do with anything? And, you know, I suppose I find it massively interesting that Ballyturk, you know, and the type of work that Ballyturk is, you know, are going out as our representatives abroad. And I just wonder, what does it say about Irish theatre? That it is beautiful, that it is linguistically very clever and very, very smart, but ultimately doesn't say very much about Ireland, or ultimately doesn't say very much about, you know, the Ireland of 2014. And again, feel free to take me up on these, during the talk, Eugene, or perhaps afterwards, because, you know, my reading on these is designed to be deliberately provocative in some respects. The second piece to mention is the fourth part of a project that's been running on over the last number of years, made by Louise Lowe and Anu Productions. And this was over the last 5 years at the Dublin Theatre Festivals, Anu have presented confrontational site-specific works on the streets of the North Inner City, excavating the area's social and political history. Their ambitious Montes also concluded this year with Varda, which I saw last week. It combined interactive performance and installations, limited to four audience members at a time. So, I've seen most of them, and I still found it incredibly in your face this time around. You're one of four. You're brought at all times by an actor, by several actors, into rooms such as this, which is a bedroom, into a car, into a shop, and you're brought around all of these sites. The cumulative effect of the four-part cycle is of layers of history imprinted on a constantly changing landscape. World's End Lane invoked Montreux's years as a red light district in the early 20th century. Laundry brought audiences into a convent, one of the infamous Magdalene laundries, where women were effectively imprisoned by the Catholic Church over decades. The Boys of Foley Street covered the rise of criminal gangs amid the heroin crisis of the 70s. And Bardo shows how heroin, the district has returned to its past, with illegal sex workers holed up in new apartment blocks, intimidated by female bosses who move them on at short notice. In Disturbing Encounters, alone in a bedroom with a sex worker who produces a gun, or taken in a car and made complicit in the coercion of a young Russian immigrant who tries to escape, each spectator is required to respond and participate. Pushing a shopping trolley into a bus station alongside a teenager who hisses, "Just act normally," we meet a desperate Nigerian man who can't go home for his father's funeral, as he has no legal documents. Amid the seemingly humdrum every evening rush hour, we encounter secret histories and hidden misery in the most direct way possible. And it's incredibly potent and incredibly powerful theatre. But I suppose my trajectory in this is trying to discuss is how accessible, how much theatre of the people is this? Four people got to see it. It was played four times a day, so 16 people got to see it each day over the course of a two-week run. I'm not good at maths, but you can figure that one out for yourself. And yet, and as with Ballyshore, this is held up as being, the finest of what we make at the moment. And I have no quibble with its artistic integrity and ingenuity, but I just wonder, as a piece of theatre, does it ask some questions of us in terms of what a popular theatre and what a theatre of the people might be? The final piece is actually one we staged here in the Limestone Theatre, and this was funded by the City of Culture Programme. So my theatre clubs, my Ross, sought to tell the story of an area. I'll just read a little bit from the advertising blurb. Is there as much talent in my Ross as there is under the Hollywood sign? My Ross is famous. My Ross is a brand. Who made it that way? This is our side of the story. We're taking to the stage and we're going to own it. This is our right of reply. Today in my Ross, a group of kids built a fort. It's not known the exact outcomes, but sources at the scene say it's a grand old fort indeed. If you've never been to my Ross, but only read about it in the papers, you would have a very different idea of what kind of place it is. We want to bring you there, to the real my Ross. My Ross will show the difference between the people's lives and the headlines. Featuring a massive community cast of the very young and the very old, this is a night at the theatre you won't forget in a hurry. So I'm just beginning to talk to the people who made my Ross about kind of evaluating that and their intent in going into the work. But what was interesting about my Ross, it was certainly if it was staged in our theatre, which is 500 seats, the world and her mother could come and see it. There was certainly availability of tickets, but they didn't. The people who came to see my Ross were the people of my Ross. So again, I'm a deliberately chosen theatre club because if you take, Landmark Productions, ANU, or our theatre club, these are the sexiest of Irish theatre producers at this moment in time. But it begs the question that, all of this begs the question that irregardless of their social intent, their pro-social intent, these events are niche. They're niche artistic engagement. You have to be very much in the know to get to them in some respects. You have to be very aware of what's happening out there. They certainly don't lay any claims to mass entertainment or popular entertainment as Granny did. Now Granny, again for those of you who are visitors, Granny was another City of Culture project this year, produced by Royal Deluxe, which is a Belgian company. Granny was by any metric, an astounding success. Over 3 days in Limerick in late August, early September, 500,000 people came onto our streets. We have an inter-institutional project looking at the impact of Granny at the moment. But I think, and obviously it's too early to kind of say definitively what kind of outcomes arose from it. But, what I do know is that every hotel in the city was sold out. What I do know is just from my own experience of being on the streets and experiencing a Limerick that was utterly, utterly different. Experiencing a type of community, a type of camaraderie, a type of citizenship, a type of engagement with the landscape of the city that was radically different to that which I'd ever experienced before. This isn't regarded as theatre, and yet 500,000 people saw this work. So I suppose all of this, in terms of contemporary work, four productions that have been on in the last number of months, raises many questions, and these questions have been in my mind for many, many years, as to what is theatre, How do we represent it? How do we make it? Where do we put the emphasis? How do we explain what Irish theatre might be? Eugene, I have no idea of time, so will you just keep it?
Okay,
I can stay here till four. Can I?
Yeah, no, I'll stay here.
You can
end
it.
Thanks, Ian. There's Granny in close up. Let's just go back for a second. And I suppose, ultimately, the nub of what I want to share with you today is that I feel, and I've tried to illuminate for you, that we actually have, I suppose, quite a dysfunctional and enigmatic dramatic tradition in Ireland that we don't understand particularly well. I would argue that actually in Ireland our roots in the theatre are very far from the stage. The Irish theatre is, through its origins, an oral, communal, participatory, socially conservative, but also politically active theatre. Each of those terms, as you'll appreciate, contains an essay in themselves, but suffice to say, much of our theatre was not written, ever, until the mid-18th century. It was highly community-oriented, it was loosely framed aesthetically, such as Granny, and generally served a very precise social function. Alan Fletcher, who's a UCC academic, explains that very, very well in a book called The Polity and Performance of Pre-Cum World in Ireland. And he talks about the fact that until the 20th century, theatre performance, as I will from now on refer to it, was actually a social necessity as opposed to a social nicety. If we broaden our understanding of drama and theatre away from the vernacular, away from the received and understood, to encompass work like Granny, it can remain such. But I suppose I would argue that we tend not to. That theatre and performance remains in those places that I characterised it as such at the very start of the talk. Looking back on the historical trajectory of Ireland, and return to that notion of it being an oral communal as opposed to a private literary theatre, you can see that the playhouses of the 18th century, which were colonial entities, set up largely to entertain the Anglo-Irish and to entertain the garrisons in cities like Limerick and Dublin and Wexford and so on and so forth, had limited success. The great playwrights of the 18th century, again I cited earlier, Boucicault, Wilde, Farquhar, had to emigrate to the mainland, as it then was, to achieve any modicum of success. And even the great Gaelic literary revival failed to bring the masses into the newly established auditorium. This is because the literary theatre, experienced privately and largely created for the purposes of social entertainment, was not of the people, particularly the rural poor. The drama of a great number of the Irish people was of another sort. I'm going to have to skip through these, of course, I put these in the wrong order. The drama of the great number of the Irish people was of another sort. It happened in the pre-Christian and in the early Christian rituals that still mould our calendar. In our churches, the great houses, The fields of play, the town squares, the rambling houses, the wake houses, the crossroads. It looked like, and still looks like, not the drama or theatre as we currently know it, but the stuff of everyday life. The drama that I'm speaking about, the performances that I'm speaking about, feel actually like the stories that we tell. The things that we do as part of our everyday existence, even now. So things like waking the dead, the way in which we celebrate marriages, you know, the great life rituals. And they are part of the normal functioning of perhaps what it means to be Irish. It is almost, in some respects, an invisible theatre, to appropriate a phrase of Augustus Wilde's. And I've just thrown in a couple of images here. This is an image from the bardic tradition of great houses. My colleague Stephen is down the back and could explain this to a much greater degree than I did. But when wandering poets and musicians travelled from great Gaelic house to great Irish house, and they composed music and poetry in honour of their patron, in honour of their host, and then performed it at the dinner table, as you've seen in the scene before you. You know, nowadays we still see things like the Puck Fair, which happens in a town called Lorgan in County Kerry, where a puck goat, a male goat, is idolised and worshipped and raised to an elevated platform and is the epicentre, really, of the fairly raucous celebrations that happen over the course of the next numbers of days. So I suppose my argument is that in some respects these dramatic traditions are actually more redolent of an Irish theatre than the plays of Boucicault and Farquhar. That these traditions, you know, and they have modified and changed over the years, but these traditions tell us more about what maybe Irish theatre is or should be than many of the plays I cited earlier. Trying to theorise this very, very briefly, the work of Richard Schechner gives a broader idea. Schechner is an NYU-based academic who, I suppose, is regarded as the founding father of performance theory. He considers performance in the broadest possible vein, and with these seven interlocking spheres of performance. And he talks about, obviously, you know, the need to entertain, but also to teach or persuade, to create beauty, to change or make identity, to heal, to deal with the divine and the demonic. So this is an interesting kind of way of exploding what a theatre might look like. Because actually Shakespeare says that fundamentally performance, which is at the heart of all theatrical work, has many, many different tasks. At the heart of which is to entertain. Because if you're not engaged, if you're not entertained, there's absolutely no point in you being there. But added to this, he deals with 8 distinct categories of performance. He talks about performance as being everyday life, cooking, socializing, gathering communally to speak, to talk, to share ideas. He talks about performance in the arts, clearly that's one that's immediately recognizable. He talks about performance in sport, or in popular entertainment. He talks about performance in business, in technology, in sex, in ritual, be it sacred or secular, and in play. And actually, you know, that Shakespeare's work fits very much alongside many, many other theories, mostly from the field of sociology, amongst whom is the work of Richard Sennett, who talks about the art of public acting, and that actually, as citizens, we play many, many different parts. As people, we play many, many different parts every day of the week. So we play the part, in my case, as a husband, as a son, as a colleague, as a supervisor, as, you know, a friend, one hopes, to my friends, and so on and so forth. And that actually, life consists of us acting all the time. And that we can discern an awful lot of our human behavior as being forms of acting. Shakespeare also, you know, allied to this, suggests that performance always consists of 2 intertwined strands, efficacy and entertainment. At different times in the history of any culture scenario, these strands are visible in varying capacities, as Shakespeare himself illustrates here. So what he's talking about, and apologies to those of you who can't see that, is that the solid line represents entertainment, and the top line represents efficacy. And Shakespeare is suggesting here that from the 1500s right through into the current century, these have shifted in times, in a kind of wave of motion, in terms of their importance. So that at the 1800s, the entertainment factor, and that's in keeping with the growth of naturalism and realism, the theatre of Strindberg and so on and so forth, the entertainment function was the primary function. Whereas that actually nowadays, and this work is old, but I think it holds, that the efficacious function of performance and theatre is actually paramount. So he talks about paratheatre, experimental performance, political theatre, performative psychotherapies and so on and so forth. For those of us used to simply visiting the theatre, this broadening of horizons, I suppose, represents a significant challenge. However, locating theatre within this broader concept of performance may also represent a chance for us to explain our dramatic and dysfunctional dramatic history. More importantly, and the substantial point I want to make here, is that it allows us to consider deeply the societal function that the theatre holds. To entertain, yes, absolutely, but also to educate and to inculcate our young people into core aspects of societal life. To allow us to participate in all aspects, celebrations of community, celebrations of life, death, and everything in between. Much of this understanding of the function of theatre has been lost in the last century, although some, like Lionel Pilkington, note its importance, its ongoing importance, and I quote, "To understand the relationship between theatre and Ireland, it is not enough to study theatrical representation as it takes place within the institution of theatre. Theatre in Ireland is a cultural phenomenon that is not restricted to the professional, urban, building-based theatre. Theatrical performance is not just the enactment of a literary script, but also a playful public intervention, a testimony to the resilience of alternative ways of thinking, remembering and imagining action, and a whole-scale stretching out of what a society thinks might be possible." It's undeniable, I suppose, to my mind, that in Celtic Tiger Ireland, theatre in Ireland lost cognizance of this function entirely. Pat Lonergan's wonderful book, Theatre and Globalisation, Irish Drama in the Celtic Tiger Era, speaks eloquently of how that theatre was more concerned with looking outwards than inwards, with success and mobility than insight and explanation. And I suppose my great fear is that now we're emerging, you know, we've had the Celtic Tiger, we've had the recession, we're now beginning to see something like the green shoots of growth, is that in revitalising and re-energising an Irish theatre, that we will stay with the meaning of what Irish theatre should be that emerged during the Celtic Tiger. Niall Crowley, who was formerly CEO of the Quality Authority, offering a fairly scathing critique 2 years ago at the Theatre Forum Conference, which actually incidentally was held here this year, and he suggested that in these current times of turmoil, theatre and the arts appear more distant, aloof and separate. This is not evidence of a more evolved, civilised and cultured Ireland. It is closer to a betrayal of tradition, a loss of purpose. This betrayal is not unique to theatre and the arts. It is shared across the different sectors of civil society. The largesse of our Celtic Tiger economy has had a deadening impact on all parts of civil society that has served to distract and disarm. So leaving aside for a moment the broader socio-cultural remit of theatre, there are also some more pragmatic neglects. And I'm going to return to my limestone motif here. Because there was not, over the course of the Celtic Tiger, there was a growth in work, but there was no simultaneous investment in the modes by which we either make artists or consumers of theatre, if I can be as crude as to say that. There seems in Ireland to be a pervasive cultural belief that we somehow grow artists and theatre audiences, that the limestone somehow creates mystical, through mystical and mythical modes of working, creates artists. The legacy of the Celtic Tiger was the commodification of neo-colonial and neo-colonialising of cultural work, and the rampant alienation of many quarters of Irish society from the arts, in particular the theatre. And there is now an inherent danger that that legacy will continue when the money starts rolling again, as we hope it does. Allied to this, our conservative cultural and educational tradition, theatre does not fit within it, because it flies in the face of a neo-liberal globalised agenda, and apologies for throwing these terms around the place, because theatre fundamentally, as an educative force, promotes cooperative, dialogic, agency-laden citizenship. It provokes, it moves, it forces us to ask questions. And fundamentally, I think that in our dysfunctional theatrical tradition, and it's fine putting it on paper, but I think there's a practical manifestation of this, and that is that a lack of understanding that we possess a performative and oral communal theatre heritage, rather than simply a private literary theatrical tradition, may mean that when we start to revisit the arts and we start to look at the arts again in terms of growth, that we neglect many of the functions that are of the limestone of this island. Many of the functions that are, I suppose I would argue to some degree, native to what theatre means on this side. How are we doing, Yush?
Five.
Okay, I'm in the last section. Have I poured you all to that yet? Good. I hope not. So the implications of this are multifaceted, I suppose. The implications of our misrepresentation of an Irish theatrical tradition. That's, you know, all of what I've said, I suppose, in terms of what things were, and are to a degree. But there's a new optimism in the air, thankfully. At the beginning of what we hope to be a period of stable economic growth, we now have an opportunity to consider what we feel to be the shape and also the function of theatre in our society. And that's in keeping with the calls to develop a new republic, which were very, very prominent 2 or 3 years ago, which have died down significantly over the last number of years. But I would argue that we need to maintain that momentum of reconceptualizing, rethinking what the Republic of Ireland means, what it stands for, what Irishness stands for. And I suppose for that reason, I welcome the fact that we now have an academic node here that will hopefully keep that discourse alive and keep it active. In this time of opportunity, I would argue that it's important we don't simply allow the limestone to passively continue to brew our theatrical heritage, but that we actually begin to mine, that we begin to get in there, we begin to start to excavate, and we begin to actively reconstruct what the theatre means in Ireland. The implications of this are across a number of fronts. For theatre makers, where do they go from here? I don't have the answers to these, maybe you will. What do they make? How do they connect with a new audience? Do they begin to reinvent or invent a popular Irish theatre? Or do they continue to make work in their own niches, in their own nodes, that might not perhaps reach those masses of largely rural Irish people who don't attend the formal literary Irish theatre? For communities, and these communities are those communities I've just mentioned are the communities I speak of, we have to generate an understanding of performance, and therefore theatre, that promotes engagement and reconnects the theatre to our public. Our theatre needs to be of the limestone people, if I can put it like that. So, you know, this arrogance and snobbery that exists at times within Irish theatre, whereby the local amateur drama society are putting on a play, we need to find a way of bridging the gap, because actually there's an awful lot of good work being done in amateur theatre around this country. And across traditions, like the level of somebody I've been fortunate to work with, I'm directing a play at the moment for an amateur group, I've been fortunate enough to work on many, many musicals and plays over the years. And I happily live between those two worlds of the professional and the amateur. and the amount of scorn and ridicule that is thrown upon amateur drama by my colleagues in the professional sector is incredible. And it's not worthy, and it's not, you know, I have no idea where it comes from, because actually the work, I would argue, that happens in amateur companies at times can be much more sophisticated than that which happens in the so-called professional theatre. So reconnecting our communities to the theatre is, I think, a challenge. There's a challenge for audiences. We have to get past the colonial playhouse syndrome. We have to make the realisation that we're not simply a private literary theatre that exists in the towns and cities fortunate enough to have a venue. The appetite is there, and even since we've opened the Lime Tree, we've had, you know, 170,000, 180,000 people through our doors. The appetite is there in just over 2 years for people to attend the theatre. And the onus is on the sector now to look to its tradition, however it understands it, and to make work that reaches those audiences. As a teacher, the next one is one I feel most profoundly about, because for me, we have to rail against dramatic illiteracy in Ireland. And there is dramatic illiteracy. We have an absolute minimum teaching of drama in our primary school system, and none in our secondary school system. So with the generation that young people are largely dramatically illiterate, with the, you know, and people even who are passionate and who go into the arts as a career choice don't know very much about the art form that they're working within. Drama and theatre need to become part of not just the written curriculum, but what I would call the legitimate curriculum too. You know, we talk a lot in education about the hidden curriculum, and I suppose I would argue that the legitimate curriculum is what is actually valued in our schools. And drama and theatre seem not to be. For structures, we have to look at the development of an arts infrastructure in Ireland beyond the accidental mode in which most of it has found its way. We have to look at our national culture boards. And you know, just the farce of the last 2 or 3 weeks in terms of government appointments to the board of the Irish Museum of Modern Arts, you know, it's emblematic really of the way in which our government treats our cultural institutions. And again, for those of you who are visitors, what happened was that a politician, a Fine Gael politician, who was about to hit the election trail to become elected, or to go for election to our upper house, to the Senate, was appointed to a state board for the Museum of Modern Art a week before his election campaign was announced. He subsequently withdrew from the board and lost the election. But you know, it tells a story of how our government sees the arts in Ireland, and theatre in Ireland. And finally, for funding. One of the most significant planks of the last Minister of Arts, Jimmy Deanan, who was our last Minister for Arts, Heritage and Development, I suppose I'll remember for two particular things. When Royal Deluxe was announced earlier this year, he referred to it as a glorified puppet show. And subsequently brought, you know, what happened was the artistic director who had programmed the event lost his job as a result of interventions, not quite that intervention, but of interventions similar to it. But Jimmy's other major contribution to arts policy in Ireland was the development of a whole policy framework around philanthropic funding. Now in Ireland, and again for those of you who are visitors from the US and elsewhere, philanthropy is a major facet of funding the arts around the world. It's not in Ireland. It tends not to be in Ireland. We do have kind of institutional philanthropy, such as that offered by this institution, which hosts a theatre. But philanthropy has its place. It's not part of our cultural tradition just yet. And it's just not good enough that a Minister for Arts would start to say, well, actually, the main mode of funding into the future is going to be philanthropic. And it belies a deeper issue, you know, that with regard to the state and its relationship towards the arts. We're more than happy to take the arts and to sell the arts and theatre in particular, but we don't want to support them. You know, and again, that notion of Liveline running amok. Liveline is a call-in show on our radio, and callers on Liveline running amok at the idea that, you know, a theatre company are getting $500,000 when that could go to hospital beds. Again, for me, that represents a particular problem. In terms of funding, we have to also guard against a particular belief that our artists can somehow live off the limestone. They can't. It's a rock. So, with all the symbolic potency of our underlying rock, and all the visual and aesthetic glory that it presents itself in, the same is true of theatre. Both can act as beautiful and visible reminders of who we are and whence we came. But if we're not careful, they can also be caves in which we are trapped, content to recycle the old, without ever really taking a step out into the light. I mentioned Auden earlier on, and just quote to finish a few lines from his very lengthy poem on Limestone. They were right, my dear, all those voices were right, and still are. This land is not the sweet home that it looks. nor its peace to historically calm of a site where something was settled once and for all. A backward and dilapidated province, connected to the busy, big world via tunnel, with a certain seedy appeal. Is that all it is now? Thank you.